You are not only a public intellectual, but you're also, I know, to be steeped in Judaism and also a student of Jewish history. Put this in history, Jewish history, for me.
Well, one measure of the gravity of what Hamas did in those Israeli towns is that they perpetrated an event that actually can take its place in the long history of savagery against the Jews. Not every anti-Semitic incident falls into that sordid tradition, but this one takes its place in that awful history. You know, people are rightly calling it a pogrom.
Yes.
Some of them are comparing it to a historically transformative pogrom in Kishinev in 1903. But you know, the interesting thing about the pogrom in Kishinev, which had repercussions, I mean, it changed Jewish culture and Jewish politics permanently, is that the number of people who were killed at Kishinev was 49. That was it. And here we have a pogrom that is responsible for the murder of 1,300 Jews. And that is the sort of event that we have a holiday called Tisha B'Av, in which we mourn all the tragedies and destructions. And this event will take its place in the sort of dark lineage of those commemorations. It
Nothing
is,
compares, obviously, to the Holocaust, and no one
look,
says it
of
in
course
says it
not,
in,
but
and no
here's the
one says
thing.
it in the same breath. But
Well, one
is
doesn't
this
set the
the
standard at 6 million, Charlie. I mean, there is, there was, for example, Bret Stephens the other day said that this is the worst thing that's happened to the Jews since Auschwitz and Bergen-Belsen.
I saw that.
Well, no, because many more people were killed daily in those places. And when we say it was like the Holocaust, we're talking about the mass shootings of thousands. You know, in Babi Yar, 33,000 Jews were killed on a weekend. So, you know, even when we talk about the Holocaust, we have to, reserve a special place
Absolutely.
for it, in, even though it is continuous with this
But it is
anti-Semitic.
now part of the history of the assault.
You know, I'm, it is, you know, since, you know, to be perfectly personal about it, certainly it is the most Jews who were slaughtered in a day since the kind of day in 1942 when my family was slaughtered by the Einsatzgruppen in the ravines of Galicia. I mean, they're, you know, but again, you know, moral judgments are not based, are not made quantitatively, but still one must keep proportion.
When did you find out on Saturday morning, and who did you reach out to?
The news filtered in when I realized what had happened. I didn't reach out to anybody. I wept and I opened some books. I read some Hebrew poems that have to do with slaughter. And then I began to call Israeli friends, as many as I could reach, just to give them a hug. I mean,
Right.
I was so shocked that this was not a time for analysis yet. It was a very, one had the feeling of one's world shaking. My fury at Netanyahu, which I never thought could be any bigger than it already was incalculable. I mean, this was a systemic failure, a breakdown of Israeli security from the top, from the prime minister's office to the chief of staff, to the defense minister, to the director of intelligence, to logistics, even to the strategic concept about Hamas and the West, and Gaza that Netanyahu had been peddling.
And the only person that has spoken to that that I know of, and I'm not in Israel at the moment, I'm in New York City, but the only person that I know that has spoken to that in an official capacity is the head of Shin Bet.
That's right. The director of intelligence has owned up to the failure and taken responsibility. Netanyahu never will. He will blame the military and the intelligence apparatus, and he will blame the protests in the months preceding this. But certainly in the beginning, in the first week, there was a perfectly necessary and understandable feeling that right now the most urgent thing is to get past the shock and gird one's loins and get to the task at hand. I mean,
and
right
what
now,
what is the task at hand?
Defending Israel against what just happened.
And does that mean?
It means severely punishing Hamas. It means, in my view, it means recognizing that this Israeli government's and the Israeli right's lunatic obsession with the settlements and the settlers and the West Bank has had grave consequences, because it was an ideological and religious and crazy emphasis that, in fact, it's the Palestine Authority, it's the Palestinian Authority that needs to be strong and needs to be in some constructive relationship with Israel, and that building up Hamas and pretending that Hamas was anything but what it was so that everybody can look away from their plans for the settlements, for the West Bank. I don't mean Hamas's plans. I mean the Israeli annexationist chauvinist right, among whom I now include Netanyahu. The whole strategic concept was wrong. It was just...
I'm going to come back to the question of what commissions might do.
There will be commissions.
Yeah, there clearly will be. But, and it may be too early to answer this question, though. How do you think, what will this change? The fact that this horrific event has happened, that Israel has to respond, and that you have now among Arab states people in the streets because of damage done to a hospital.
This sets many things back, which was the strategic objective of Iran and of Hamas. It certainly, on the Israeli side, will have the effect of hardening the Israeli population, of making them less forthcoming for perfectly understandable psychological reasons. But nonetheless, it would be a very foolish and short-term response for the simple reason that millions of Palestinians are not going anywhere, and nobody, no Jewish government, is going to push them out. So I think that, it's going to have the opposite effect. On the Palestinian side, Hamas is already achieving its objective of making the PA even more invisible than it already was, and also Hamas is now a hero. Hamas is now a hero. They have done something heroic.
To Palestinians,
to Arabs in various states. They defeated Israel. We have to be clear here. They didn't destroy Israel, but destruction is not the only defeat that a state can suffer. This was an Israeli defeat. And they know it. It was a successful attempt, not just to call attention to themselves.
But clearly, Leon, not all Palestinians are celebrating this attack.
Well, I'll tell you.
Invasion by...
No, they're not. No, they're not. But, no, they're not. And again, I'm not going to generalize about Palestinians the way I shouldn't generalize about Israelis. But for every Palestinian who believes in what they call the resistance, and certainly the armed resistance, what happened was an unimaginably exhilarating event. And we see this. I mean, you see how they and their supporters, this group of Palestinians, is responding. It's heartbreaking because obviously all Palestinians don't support this. The grand bargain that the United States and Saudi Arabia were working on with Israel is now shattered, at least for a very long time.
Do you really think so? I mean, do you think this
oh, I do.
Cannot afford to
I
come
do.
Back and say...
Yeah, I do. Look, the only way this bargain was going to work, and I'm not sure, first, that it was going to work, and secondly, frankly, that it was a good idea.
Well, and thirdly, that it was only going to work with the U.S. Participating
right.
as a defense guarantee.
But what that means, it would only work if Biden had the support of the Democrats on the Hill. And what that means, given the culture of the Democratic Party, is that what would be have to be offered to the Palestinians as part of this grand bargain would have to be, I think, much more than the Israelis were prepared to accept before this atrocity, and certainly more than they're going to be prepared to accept after it.
Let me interrupt you. Just say one thing, only because of when I called you and asked you to do this, the first time I called you, you were sick in bed with a flu.
Yes. Yes.
And I can still see some.
I'm still sniffling. Yeah.
I want to explain to the audience why there's a bit of residue of cold or flu.
Thank you for your compassion.
But continue the Saudi deal.
So I think
which
this
everybody
grand plan
had
is over
for
a while. I mean, it's over for a long time. I mean, again, I thought it was a bad idea in that I don't see anything that the Saudis have to give that would be worth giving them nuclear energy or extending an American security guarantee to them. Anything.
Which was their
there already was peace between Saudi Arabia and Israel. The Saudis are not about to attack the Israelis on their own. We also have learned in Yemen about the incompetence of the Saudi military. The Saudis are going to stay approximately where they are, which is even with MBS. I know he wants to modernize and do exciting things, but strategically in the region, I think that the grand bargain was a genuinely bad idea. In any case, the Iranians certainly wanted to blow it up, because if you looked at it on paper, it certainly would have been a strategic defeat for Iran.
Well, in part, it was against Iran. That was the purpose of it.
Yes, yes, exactly, exactly. But again, you know, the Saudis and Iran, do you remember the Iranians actually one morning some years ago fired missiles at Saudi Arabia and blew up Saudi Aramco's refinery?
I do well.
It was a raw act of unprovoked aggression. And the Saudis did nothing. Nothing. So, you know, the Saudis are a reed in the wind. We don't need them for oil. They are already...
But they're more than that. They are within the Islamic world.
They are. They
a
are.
A factor. And
they are.
Clearly...
They are. They are. But... You know, when Israel made the deals, the Abraham Accords with the Gulfies, the deal was a responsible deal on both sides. I don't see if the grand bargain was to be made, it would if, God forbid, it were to be made according to the terms that were being reported, the Saudis would wind up with some nuclear energy, or they would wind up with some Japan-like security guarantee from the United States. The deal would be made, I assure you, without in anything transformative for the Palestinian situation. And Netanyahu's reputation would have been rehabilitated. I don't see anything good about any of this. I really don't. In fact, I still think that Iran is the major villain here. Iran is what we have to focus on.
Even though, let's try to define what their role might have been. I mean, everyone recognizes, and they take some pride, I guess, in the fact that they have been supportive of Hamas and supportive of Hezbollah and supportive of other groups less well known. But as far as I know, the U.S. has said they have no hard evidence that they knew of this particular awful, horrific day.
Look, this is not about a smoking gun. We know that the Iranians have not just supported this. They have also supplied Hamas as best they can. The armaments that they would supply Hamas with were not given to them for the reconstruction of buildings in Gaza City. What they gave them was for one purpose and one purpose only, which was eventually in some circumstance to be used. There's no other way to interpret. The same, by the way, the situation in Lebanon with Hezbollah is a little more complicated because it's pretty clear that Nasrallah does not want to see Lebanon destroyed and does not want to be responsible for its destruction.
Well, not only that, Nasrallah has said on the record that in 2006,
if the
response had been, he would not have done it.
He would not have done it. Exactly. Nonetheless, Nasrallah has been accepting as many missiles from the Iranians as can get across Syria without the Israelis bombing the convoys. So, it's what I'm saying is that, and if you look at who benefits from this regionally, the obvious answer is Iran. During the debate in 2015, 14, 15, 16, well, the continuing debate about the Iran nuclear deal, owing in part to Israeli pressure, but also owing to a sound strategic concern about their nuclear capability, we all focused obsessively on their nuclear capability and neglected to develop a strong policy against what was and is the more immediate Iranian threat, which is their regional imperialism.
Exactly. Well,
Iranians now own Lebanon, Syria, half of Iraq, they're in Yemen, they're in Gaza.
So therefore, what should be the response directed?
The response is to make life difficult for Iran globally.
Is that happening?
By what right is Iran occupying Syria? By what right does Iran control Lebanon? By what right does Iran make its mischief in Iraq and make it impossible for Iraq to cohere as a state? By what right are they in Yemen? And, for that matter, by what right are Iranian operatives in Managua and Caracas?
Let me shift to stay with Iran, but at the same time shift to the United States. How do you assess the role so far of President Biden?
I think Biden has been, I think it's the most gifted American diplomatic performance since Kissinger. I think that he has been tonally perfect, and we saw that just in recent days. He has been tonally perfect in three ways. First, he is obviously a feeling human being who knows how to talk to people who suffer. It's not phony, it's not tactical, it comes from the man.
And
he has found a way to comfort not just individuals, but populations of people. It's extraordinary. Thereby, I should add, building up his credibility, certainly in Israel. I mean, he would win the Israeli election by a landslide right now. Secondly, he stood by Israel really in what, in it maybe its darkest day, certainly in one of its two or three darkest days. And he made the Israelis who were really bleeding, he helped them recover their balance. And he made the world less frightening for them. Which is an important thing. But thirdly, and this is what we've just seen, the really brilliant part, and not just the human part, is that by taking the extraordinary step of going to Israel during the war, knowing full well what this would do to America's reputation in the Arab and Muslim world, Biden now is in a position. He's in on Israel's planning. One of the reasons he went there was to see, and this is obvious now, was to see what he could do about moderating the Israeli response and making the coming Israeli incursion into Gaza less catastrophic than it otherwise might be.
And what else he did was he framed it in terms of mistakes learned.
Yes.
From
9/11. Yes. Now, the combination of all this, the empathy, the support, the moral support, and the practical support, and then the somehow his insertion of himself and Tony Blinken actually into the planning for the Israeli response, so that we might have some impact upon its ferocity.
Blinken spent 7 hours with the war council.
Yeah. Look, it's clear that it was Biden who persuaded Sisi to open Rafah to get those supplies through.
The trucks that are going in.
Yeah. I mean, well, or to delay it, or just to mitigate it. And now some Israelis are already saying that Netanyahu took the bait. And now, for the first time in Israel's history, another power, even if it's Israel's best friend by orders of magnitude, has now been included in Israeli planning and now play a role in how the Israelis strategically and tactically conceive their operation. Now, this is unprecedented. This has never happened.
And is it good or bad?
I think it's good if you're interested in, as they say, flattening Gaza, which I am not, it's bad because it means that Israel may not have the total freedom of action in its planning that the people searching for revenge want it to have. So it's complicated.
Allow me to stay with the U.S. and its participation and what Biden has done and what the Secretary of State has done. Has this made it, in a sense, America's war as well?
Look, you know, I don't know what it means to say America's war. America is a great power.
Well, meaning that the U.S. is in and it's...
Yes, in the sense that even if Biden hadn't gone, we are, you know, he made it clear that there's no daylight between the Americans and the Israelis. So will the great power sponsor of the Israeli offensive, of the Israeli retaliatory operation, will they be held partly responsible for it? Yes. In the same way, I guess, that I just held Iran partly responsible for what happened in Israel. Sure, but you know, we are a great power. We get into such situations, and our values and our interests both require land us in these situations.
My understanding of what you have said in the past about other situations is that you want the United States to accept the role of a great power.
I do.
And act like a great power.
I do. I think if you want a laboratory, if you wanted to run a laboratory experiment about what the world would look like if the United States withdrew from its prominence, we've been running it since the Obama administration. The world has become a more and more Hobbesian place. All sorts of villains and bad actors have been greenlit by the absence of any American impediments and obstacles to what they want to do. When we respond to certain atrocities, as we are doing magnificently, but I don't know for how long in Ukraine, we are always playing catch up. We are always doing the right thing too late because our internal political culture wants to slow us down or shut us down in this regard. Yes, I think that America's, you know, absence from the world has been disastrous for many places in the world.
And you think that's been true through both the Obama and the Trump administration?
That's right. The Obama and Trump. That's 12 years. 12 years is a century in international affairs.
Well, that's a subject for another conversation. But
yeah,
let me. I don't know how to ask this question, but when you point out that the Jewish people have gone through so much,
yeah,
and you see the horror that those who were massacred and slaughtered on October 7th, you know.
Yeah.
And yet you see the faith that remains. It's remarkable.
Look, there are people, I understand when people draw even theological conclusions from the astonishing fact of the survival of the Jewish people. And not just its survival, but its survival as a civilization, as a rich civilization, and its restoration of its language and its restoration of its sovereignty and its land. I hasten to add, it's a land it should have to share, but in its land.
Let me just be clear. It's land that it should share, and there should be a two-state solution.
Yes, but you see, here's why. There is the theological, philosophical, emotional uplift and wonder that one takes away from the story of Jewish survival against astonishing odds, and the story of Jewish flourishing against astonishing odds. But it's important to understand that collective memory is not a basis for state policy. That is to say, you know, the memory of the Jewish past lends meaning and certain valences to certain contemporary events that could be edifying, especially for Jews. But when it comes to securing the achievements of the Jews, when it comes to securing their survival, the only questions are empirical ones and strategic ones and secular ones. You know, policy is not made by mysticism. Policy is made according to the needs of the moment. And so, according to Jewish collective memory, in Jewish collective memory, we have been persecuted and attacked in every generation by essentially the same enemy, which began in the Bible, and he was called Amalek, or it was called Amalek. And Jews historically interpret the Babylonians, the Romans, the Crusaders, the 17th century Ukrainian persecutors, the White Russian pogroms, the Nazis, you know, and so on, and some, you know, Palestinian terrorists are included in this too. That is a repetition of the pattern of Jewish history. It's all Amalek. But for planners, you can't lump, it's not one enemy. For planners, you have to really look at the differences as well as the similarities, and you have to look at the concrete situation, and you have to do what's in the best interest of your state, regardless.
Which brings me to this question. You have to do what's in the best interest of your state. If there is, and we assume there will be, and that the IDF will go into Gaza.
Yeah.
Hostages, citizens of the United States and citizens of Israel and other places, perhaps, will be at risk.
I don't have the answer to that. This situation, the hostage situation, the question of proportionality in the Israeli quest for retaliatory justice, if you believe in retaliatory justice, some people don't. These are so emotionally and intellectually excruciating, these questions. They cramp my brain. I mean, I really don't know what the answer is. I know that the Israelis are going to go in. I think that after what happened, justice requires that Hamas be severely punished. I dread the collateral damage. I hate that phrase, but I dread the full human cost of what this incursion will be. I hope that they get out quickly. I fear that they won't. These are, as I say, these oppress my heart and break my brain. I don't know the answer to that question. I do know that in the planning, in Hamas's planning for these atrocities, the kidnapping of a large number of hostages was one of their strategic objectives, because they knew exactly how this would complicate the situation. But as I said, so I don't know the answer to that. But the important thing to recognize is, whereas this October 7th was the worst day in Jewish history, in the history of anti-Jewish violence since, I don't know, hundreds of days during the Holocaust. After the Holocaust, during the Holocaust, there was no Jewish army. There was no sovereign state. There was no Jewish army. There was no possibility of self-defense. There was no possibility even of revenge, even though there were small groups that attempted it. We are now historically in precisely the new situation that Zionism sought to bring about, which is not that anti-Semitism would end or that anti-Jewish violence would end, but that when it reared its disgusting head, the Jews could mount an effective response against it, and because of that, in some cases, maybe even deter it. That was the whole point. That was the whole point.
And then the phrase, never again.
Oh, never again was a slogan that, you know, I mean, I grew up chanting it on the streets of Brooklyn and New York, but never again was never going to be the case. I mean, you know, you could even make the argument that after the Nazis did what they did to the Jews, they kind of broke the taboo and made it easier for genocides to take place. I never believed in never again. I believe in Jewish strength and Jewish readiness. That's not all I believe in. But I also believe in morality and in compassion and in sharing the land and so on. But one of the conditions of the two-state solution, one of its maybe its most important condition, is Israeli strength, because Israel will certainly not compromise from weakness.
Right. As you look around at this day, and we record this on October 19th, on Thursday, October 19th, as you look there, the Arab streets are full because of how the portrayal has taken place of the death around the hospital. What's the risk of an all-out Middle East in flames?
I don't believe it's very great. I don't think that Iran wants a war, certainly doesn't want a war with itself. I don't think that Hezbollah right now, I mean, they're perfectly willing to be a kind of strategic irritant to Israel and make the Israelis nervous, especially at this time of supreme nervousness. But I don't believe that they're going to war. I may be wrong. You know, this will strain the peace accords with the Gulfies. It will not break them. It will not break the peace accord with Egypt or with Jordan. I think that the Arab governments, the Arab regimes, are going to do what they used to do, which is let the streets exhaust themselves.
All right. So let me make my final question then, reverse of that. If you could have some of your dreams come out of this, in terms of security for Israel, in terms of a Palestinian state, what has to happen?
Oh, God. Look, here are my dreams. If you ask, what do I dream for the post-war situation?
Yes.
First thing I want to begin with is I dream that the media will wait 10 or 15 minutes before they attribute atrocities to people and would actually bother to establish the facts on the ground, because the consequences of misreporting can be really deadly.
Well, that's right? Happening. Isn't that happening at
the hospital? The hospital.
Yeah. That's what's happening.
Yeah, the hospital. The Israelis didn't do it. They didn't do it. The Times had a big headline. Now, I don't only blame the Times. I blame the speed, the velocity at which the goddamn media operates right now. I mean, it's almost impossible for them not to publish invented things. So that's the first thing, is I wish in a situation in which, plus, of course, social media, in which errors of fact can inflame whole populations and actually provoke violence, they should calm down a bit. The second thing is that what one wishes for, of course, but it's I don't believe it's going to happen, is a repeat of what happened after the Yom Kippur War. Remember, in 73, Kissinger was obsessed with the idea that Sadat must be beaten but not humiliated. Because if the Egyptians felt, if Sadat felt that they had made a point, they crossed the canal, they surprised the Israelis, and so on, that might give them the, that might be the psychological foundation for a press for peace. And that's what happened. And that's what happened. You know, if you look at the origins of the Egyptian-Israeli peace, it starts with the expulsion of the Russian Soviet advisors in 71. Then it goes to 73. It starts with the fact that the loss of the war was not humiliating for Egypt. And then and the conclusions that Sadat learned from the Israeli victory. And it goes right to 77 when his plane lands in Israel.
But didn't Golda Meir have to resign?
Well, yes, but that's an internal Israeli thing. Sure, Netanyahu will go too. Yes, she did have to resign. So did Dayan. So did Dado, the great general. Yes, yes. Yes. Which, of course, turned out to be a great historical opportunity for Helen Mirren, but never mind.
Who plays Golda Meir in a movie?
Yes. But here, I don't believe that that will be the pattern. I do not believe that after the Israelis ferociously respond to these atrocities, that anyone in Hamas will think, you know, what does Don Corleone say after they kill Sonny? This war stops now, right? I mean, I don't think they will. They will learn the lesson that this cycle has to end. I don't believe that. I don't believe it will make the Palestinians in Gaza, who are, of course, the ones who suffer miserably, even in peace, let alone in war, I don't know that it will lead them to replace their government. I don't know that it will embolden the PA, Abu Mazen, that it will embolden Abbas in some way to try to, you know, enlarge his rule towards Gaza. I don't know. I don't know that it will have the Sadat consequence.
And you don't know that the Arab states might come together and say, you know, we have to be part of some federation to make sure that Gaza is rebuilt, but not under any involvement by Hamas.
But look, there is such a federation, and it's called the Sunni bloc. And the Sunni bloc has essentially made peace with Israel, one by one by one by one.
All except Saudi Arabia.
Well, I was saying officially most of them, right. Unofficially de facto Saudi Arabia. Yeah. So I don't believe that the rebuilding of Gaza is a matter of just importing more concrete blocks and putting the buildings back up. I think what has to happen in Gaza is a political rebuilding. For as long as Gaza is governed by a radical, theocratic, anti-Semitic, violence-espousing group, there will be no rebuilding of Gaza. I really believe that. You know, and I think that now, if you asked me what would political reform in Gaza look like, I don't know. I don't know enough about the facts on the ground in Gaza, about the internal political situation in Gaza. We agree that all of the Gazans do not support Hamas enthusiastically, et cetera. But I really do believe that, and this I think the Israelis are right, that as long as Hamas rules Gaza, all rebuilding will just be a band-aid, a temporary respite from suffering that will eventually be destroyed in another paroxysm. I really do believe that. So I'm not optimistic about the morning after this war. And that's the thing in some way that weighs on me most. One other thing, Charlie. And then there's, of course, the question of Israeli political reform.
Sure.
I think that I don't see Netanyahu surviving this. I think Netanyahu has become a rolling curse on the Jewish people. I think the sooner he leaves, the better. I think his government is made up, except for Gantz and one or two other people, is made up of clowns.
But they came in as part of an emergency government.
No. Right. Gantz is just there for the emergency. Right. But the Israeli population, we'll see. We'll see, because Netanyahu and Ben-Gvir and Smotrich, they have a base. They have a base. And they will blame the army and the intelligence, as I told you, and they will blame the protesters, who will have stabbed the Jewish state in the back. I mean, it's coming. But it's Netanyahu and everything. It's hard to say what he stands for except Netanyahu. So let's say Netanyahu is now so discredited. There is such a fury against this government in Israel that with any luck, there'll be a positive consequence after the war of some national unity government of rational, competent people will be formed. That's something I hope will happen.
Thank you for doing this.
Oh, Charlie, it's good to be back at your table, as it were.
No, but thank you. You have a rich history.
It's a pleasure, my
and
friend.
You're my friend, and so therefore it was very appropriate, and I thank you for
allowing me to
put it together.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, my friend.
Good. William Wieseltier, thank you for joining us as well.
Okay. Thanks, Charlie.